Good morning. Today we are going to review the dynamics topics covered on the AP Physics 1 exam. Dynamics is the study of the motion of objects and the forces causing those motions.
Hey guys.
Hey Bob.
Hi Bob.
Flippin' physics.
Bo, what is the difference between inertial and gravitational mass?
Inertial mass is a measure of an object's inertia or a measure of its resistance to acceleration. In other words, the more inertial mass something has, the more it resists acceleration. Gravitational mass.
Gravitational mass is what we use to determine the force of gravity or the weight of an object. The force of gravity equals the gravitational mass of an object times the acceleration due to gravity.
But gravitational mass is and inertial mass are experimentally identical, so we don't normally identify the difference between the two.
Now let's talk about Newton's three laws of motion. Billy, what is Newton's first law of motion?
Newton's first law. An object at rest will remain at rest, and an object in motion will maintain a constant velocity unless acted upon by a net external force.
Correct. An object at rest will stay at rest, and an object in motion will maintain a constant velocity unless acted upon by a net external force. Two common mistakes. One, students often say an object in motion will stay in motion, which is not correct. An object in motion will maintain a constant velocity. And because velocity is a vector, it means it will maintain a constant speed and a constant direction. Two, students often leave out the word net on net external force. It is the net external force, the sum of the forces that needs to be equal to zero for the object to stay at rest or for the object to maintain a constant velocity. Bobby, what is Newton's second law?
Newton's second law. Net force equals mass times acceleration, where both force and acceleration are vectors.
True, however, it's rearranged on the AP Physics 1 equation sheet. They have it set up that the acceleration equals the net force divided by the mass, where both acceleration and the force are vectors. You can see the acceleration is directly proportional to the net force acting on the object and inversely proportional to the mass of the object. Now, when working with Newton's second law, it is important that you do a couple of things first. You need to identify the object or objects you are summing the forces on, and you need to identify the direction in which you are summing the forces. And you need to draw free body diagrams, which are also called force diagrams. Let's do one. Assuming I'm pushing horizontally on the book, Billy, what are all the forces acting on the book, and what are their directions?
The force of gravity is always straight down. The force normal is normal to the surface or perpendicular to the wall and always a push, so away from the wall. You said the force applied is horizontal, so it is directly into the wall. And the force of friction is parallel to the surface, independent of the direction of the force applied, and opposes motion. So the force of friction is up to prevent the book from sliding down. Oh, and it's static friction because the book isn't moving. And never break forces into components in your initial free body diagram on the AP test because your free body diagrams are answers. When you need to break a force into components, you redraw the free body diagram with those components.
Very nice. On the AP test, do not break forces into components on your first free body diagram. When you need to break forces into components, redraw the free body diagram. Please. Okay, let's detail some of what you just said about forces. The force of gravity acting on an object, or the weight of the object, is always down, and the equation is the force of gravity equals the mass of the object times the acceleration due to gravity. The force normal is the force normal to or perpendicular to the surface causing that force normal. And the force normal is always a push. A surface can't pull, it can only push. We also need the dimensions for force. So, Bobby, what are the dimensions for force?
Force is in newtons.
Bobby, can you please give that to me in base SI dimensions?
In base metric units, okay? A newton is a kilogram times a meter per second squared.
And you can remember that using Newton's second law. The net force, which is in newtons, is equal to the mass, which is in kilograms, times the acceleration in meters per second squared. To help you find the direction of the force of friction, remember the force of friction is always parallel to the surface, it opposes motion, and the direction of the force of friction is independent of the direction of the force applied. There are two types of friction, static friction or non-moving friction, more specifically where the two surfaces do not slide relative to one another, and kinetic friction or moving friction where the two surfaces do slide relative to one another. The equation on the equation sheet for the force of friction is this. The absolute value of the force of friction is less than or equal to the coefficient of friction, mu, times the absolute value of the force normal, where both forces are vectors. Now, because we actually have two different kinds of friction, this equation actually works out to be three subtly different equations. The force of kinetic friction is always equal to the coefficient of kinetic friction times the force normal. However, because the force of static friction will increase or decrease in an attempt to prevent the object from moving, the force of static friction is less than or equal to the coefficient of static friction times the force normal, and the maximum force of static friction is then equal to the coefficient of static friction times the force normal. Now, Bo, what can you tell me about the relationship between the coefficient of kinetic friction and the coefficient of static friction between two surfaces?
The coefficient of friction is experimentally determined and dimensionless, but I don't know what you mean by relationship.
Remember, for two surfaces, the coefficient of static friction is always greater than the coefficient of kinetic friction?
That's right. It's harder to put something into motion than it is to keep it moving.
We still have one of Newton's three laws of motion that we need to talk about. For every force object 1 applies on object 2, there is an equal but opposite force that object 2 applies on object 1, where both forces are vectors. Going back to our free body diagram of the book against the wall, and looking just at the force normal, which is the force from the wall on the book, there exists then an equal but opposite force from the book on the wall. Those two forces form a Newton's third law force pair, also sometimes called an action-reaction pair. And notice that those two forces in the Newton's third law force pair act on two different objects, the book and the wall, and those two forces act simultaneously. On an incline, we usually break the force of gravity into its components, which are parallel to the incline and perpendicular to the incline. Therefore, when we sum the forces in the directions that are parallel and perpendicular to the incline, because the acceleration perpendicular to the incline is usually zero, then the net force perpendicular to the incline is also equal to zero, which makes it easier to solve. The force of gravity parallel equals the mass of the object times the acceleration due to gravity times the sine of the incline angle. And the force of gravity perpendicular equals the mass of the object times the acceleration due to gravity times the cosine of the incline angle. And it's easy to remember which one is which, because if the incline angle is equal to 0 degrees, then the force of gravity parallel would be equal to zero, and the sine of 0 degrees equals zero. And if you are freaking out and can't remember values of trigonometric functions for common angles, be aware that there is a table of those values on the table of information, which you will be given on the AP exam.
I'd probably just use my calculator. Yep, the sine of zero is zero.
Nice.
Billy, what is translational equilibrium?
Translational equilibrium is when the net force on an object equals zero, which means the object isn't moving.
Actually, no, it means the acceleration of the object is equal to zero, which means it might be at rest.
Yeah, or it could be moving at a constant velocity. Okay, because the net force equals mass times acceleration, the acceleration is zero, which means an object in translational equilibrium is either at rest or moving at a constant velocity.
That is correct. An object in translational equilibrium will have a net force equal to zero, therefore the mass times acceleration is equal to zero, therefore the acceleration of the object is equal to zero. The object is either at rest or moving at a constant velocity. That is the end of my review of the dynamics topics covered on the AP Physics 1 exam. My next review will be about work, energy, and power. You are more than welcome to enjoy that review. And you can also go to my website where you'll find all of my lectures with lecture notes. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.